course of figuring out how to shoot the movie, we happened to find a town here in where we're sitting right now in Granger, Texas. This was a railroad town back at the kind of the turn of the century, and some of these buildings are a little bit later than 1878. We managed to come in and try and bring things back another 25, 30 years.
In this particular location, we're recreating Fort Smith 1875.
We were fortunate because there's a lot of existing reference material on Fort Smith, Arkansas, and then there's just a lot of reference on towns of the time. One of the challenges is most of that reference is all black and white. So for us doing a color film, we want to make sure that we're doing something that plays into the time period, but also the look that we're trying to achieve. We spent a long time referencing colors that would be appropriate for the period.
The main thing that was important was to have a nice wide street. They had wide streets in those days so they could turn the wagons around. That's one of the things that when they settled on building on both sides of the streets, all the streets were wide. This happened to have that. It was cobblestone, which you see we had to put dirt down on, which we just did, and we're dealing with the rain, and it's muddy, it dries out, it's muddy, so it's starting to get packed down pretty nicely. And actually, I think it came out pretty damn good.
It's been about 3 to 4 months since we started. We've had lots of carpenters and scenics and greensmen. We've built facades over a lot of these buildings. We've built into some of the buildings. We've raised awnings. Making it winter is something we started in. In fact, one day it snowed when we were here, which is an uncommon occurrence in Granger. It was a nice way to see what it will look like when we add our snow to it.
I'll tell you what was here was one, two, three, those brick buildings, they were just flat. But the tops of them are really quite interesting. And the thing about what I'm trying to do with this Western, different from other ones, is to make it, you know, post-Civil War, not a coal mining town, no swinging saloon doors, you know. It needs to be America on the uprise and have some substantial buildings. And I think all these smaller cities, like Fort Smith, Arkansas, were trying to copy Chicago or New York. And this was the last stop on the train. You know, after this, you went into the wilderness. We couldn't do blocks and blocks of a town, so it was all about embellishing this block and that side street and carefully shoot it to, you know, make it look bigger than it is. You could see that, once again, it's got really interesting shapes on top of the building, which I love. From where that yellow wood building starts to the end, there's an existing post office behind the saloon, which we have to deal with every day, rightfully so. People coming to get their mail and driving in and that. So it's a little bit of a hardship for us, but mainly probably more of a hardship for them. That's, you know, the whole town. That's our stable of carts and wagons, which will all have horses connected to them and make this street come alive. This tall, skinny building over here, this was not here. The street sort of ended there, and there was a big void in here, as you can see. The sidewalk continued across. We chiseled it out just to make it, you know, seamless into the town.
Nothing is real punchy in color. There's no bright, bright reds or bright, bright blues. We've stayed in things that are greens and off-whites and kind of keeps that sepia feel to things.
This was another sort of cornerstone for wanting to shoot in this town. It's a period bank. It's a little bit, it's probably like 1905 or 6, so it's a little bit ahead of our time, but we turned it back with some awnings and changed the signage around and put some plugs in the doors and things, and it really fits in. It like steps this town up a little bit from just the wooden facades. I love this building and how it fits in. This is the area we selected to shoot this gala scene, which in the movie it's supposed to be winter, so we've been taking the leaves off of trees manually. That took a couple of people about, you know, a week on a cherry picker just to pick off the leaves. So whatever trees are in the shot, we're trying to, you know, make it look like winter. And that's just a great tree because we're going to have this big, you know, the big hanging scene, and there's going to be, I don't know how many, maybe a couple of hundred extras. And we're going to put some people up on that roof line up there watching, which is, I think it's gonna be cool. It's just gonna let the characters and the costumes take this scene over against that blank wall over there. I think it should be pretty good. So this is the boarding house in the movie, which is a facade, fake facade that we stuck in here, and these talented painters are aging it right now. Even though it's probably fairly new in the movie, it's just, we need to age everything down so it looks good on film. Nothing, no fresh paint job ever looks good on a movie, especially for a Western, even though it's probably supposed to be new. And this street is the main shot, one of the main shots is down here. There was probably 6 telephone poles on either side with telephone lines and power lines running through them, which we had removed just so we could have this shot. There was a couple that were too expensive to take out, like this one, so we wrapped it in tree bark. And when you see it from this direction, it should appear to be a tree. This angle right here happens 4 times in the movie. So to achieve that, we had to build another little house here and 2 facades deep in the background that have those chimney stacks on them. And then a little visual effect will just funnel into nothing over there. You could probably come around the back of this and see what's going on in some of the backs of the houses. So this is the back of this facade. And we do have a couple of shots looking out the front door. We have an interior that matches this down the block, which is the whole scene inside the boarding house.
Getting in the mindset of 1875 is challenging, and stopping and looking and see what things will tell a viewer that you're not in 1875, to really remind yourself there was no plywood. There was a lot of different things that we take for granted that we see all the time now weren't there. So really keeping focus on that has been hard. But exciting too. It's fun to remember what it may have been like.
It's really the first introduction to the town, where Maddie and a hand from the farm where she lives, they arrive in the town and they're going to retrieve the body of her father, and they arrive by steam train. And so we had a train, we had to get a hold of this period steam train that we brought in specially and made arrangements with the Union Pacific, who has the rail line that's here in Granger.
This is a standard gauge locomotive, means it runs on standard gauge railroad track, which is the predominant track gauge in the United States, and that is 56.5 inches between the rails. It originally burned wood, and it was converted to oil later on when they discovered oil in East Texas and it was so cheap. It was originally built with a wooden cab. That cab was replaced with a steel cab, and then we still have that steel cab, and we replaced it with the wood cab to give it a more of a period look. This is the builder's plate, and this is the 29,900th locomotive that Baldwin built, and it was built in January of 1907 in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And that is the smoke box, and here are the cylinders, the valve chest and the steam cylinder, and that's where the steam comes to expand and drive the piston rod and turns the wheels. So it's completely self-contained as far as making its own air, compressed air for brakes, and its own electricity for lights.
Well, there's a lot of things going on up here, and normally when you're in operation, it's fairly loud up here, and the engineer and fireman learn to work with one another because you know, sometimes you can't even talk, so there's hand gestures and nodding, and everybody just sort of has to know what's going on to operate the locomotive efficiently.
There are 2 or 3 train coordinators in the country. I've been doing this since 1972. This is my 307th production. What typically happens is they'll either get me the pages or the script, and I'll do a breakdown of what the story is and see, okay, we got the train scene here and the train works here, and we'll get an estimate of how many days it is. We knew up front it was gonna be about 1 day for this show. Anything and everything that happens has to happen within the constraints of a tightly regulated industry. So this engine is federally qualified to operate on any railroad in the country, provided they'll let you operate it. Anytime we have a train like this out on the railroad, it's magic time for people. They just get all excited. The word spreads very quickly, especially in this internet age. There's a train in Granger. Next thing you know, you got lots of people out here.
It's exciting because this is the sort of thing where you've spent a lot of time and money, and our production designer, Jess Goncher, has created this fantastic, huge set. And when you build something and it looks this good and it's big and, you know, you want to be able to show it off, obviously, a little bit. It's gratifying when you get to the moment where you're finally going to photograph it in the proper way and make it look really great.
Working in the dark against your fellow man, but as sure as God made black and white, what's done in the dark will be brought to the light. You can run on for a long time, run on for a long time, run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Go tell that long-tongued liar, go and tell that midnight rider, tell the rambler, the gambler, the backbiter, tell him that God's gonna cut you down. Tell him that God's gonna cut you down. Tell him that God's gonna cut you down.